mass spectroscopy and cricket. Have you heard that right? Yes. Is there any relationship between mass spectroscopy and cricket? Answer is yes and no. There is no direct relationship between mass spectroscopy and cricket. But in this video, I'm going to explain about the theory and principles of mass spectroscopy through the language of cricket. Yes, it is an unusual match. If somebody is asking you what is mass spectroscopy, definition of mass spectroscopy is a gas-based technique for the production, separation and detection of ions. Mass spectrophotometers will only detect charged molecules or ions. Neutrals will not be detected, nor it will detect salts. A mass spectrophotometer does not actually measure the molecular mass directly, but rather the mass to charge ratio of the ions formed from the molecules. I know very well now that you are in a confused state if you are very new to the mass spectroscopy. Don't worry, in the coming 30 minutes I'm going to explain about the principles of mass spectroscopy in a very simple language of cricket. So you are all familiar with this person. He is Virender Sehwag. The number 219 is the world record he made in the one-day cricket. He was the first human being cross the mark of 200 runs in a one-day cricket. The uniqueness of Virender Sehwag is that for him there is no difference between 2020 one-day or test match. Even if he is playing at a test 2020 of 2 hours or a one-day cricket of 50 overs or a test match of 5 days, he will attack the first ball coming in front of him irrespective of the bowler is Shoaib Akhtar or a Shane Warne or a Bradley. He will attack. He is having only one strategy: hit the ball to the boundary. And this technique is having both positive and negative. As long as he is in the field, India will have a very good score. But if he got out in the first over itself, then it is going to become a big burden for the coming batsman. Why I am talking all those things? Because I have an instrument. It is called GCMS. It is gas chromatography mass spectrometry connected with smart mass spectrophotometry. This is a typical GCMS instrument looks like, and this is how a GCMS spectrum looks like. In a GCMS, the GC is the chromatographic part. Any chromatography, you will have two parts. One is a stationary phase and other one is mobile phase. Here the stationary phase is a column, silica column, and your mobile phase is gas. It can be helium, it can be nitrogen. Sometimes in high temperature GC, you are using even hydrogen. And what you are seeing is the typical GCMS spectrum. It is more or less looks like an Indian scoreboard where a score map where in the Sehwag was playing on the first 10 over, he made sixes and boundaries, and then you can see that India was scoring an average of more than six. Suddenly when he got out, you can see that the scoring rate came down. So this is a typical GCMS spectra. Why this is coming like this? Because in a GCMS spectra, we are using a technology called electron impact ionization. In the electron impact ionization, when you inject a material to GCMS, or GC column will separate your analyte based on the polarity, and then it will enter into your MS. In the MS, it is coming into a chamber. The chamber is having fast moving electrons. How these fast moving electrons formed? We have a cathode and anode. We kept in a in opposite directions, opposite sides, and we put a very high potential difference. Since because of this cathode and anode, it is producing electrons, and the electrons are moving inside the chamber. And your analyte will enter into that chamber, and it will bombard with the fast moving electrons. In another way, the electrons are, when it's because of high electrical energy, electrons are very much excited. They are trying to find out somebody to transfer their charge. So what it's going to do is, the moment it will see when a neutral molecule is coming into the chamber, it will transfer some of the charge into that molecule, and a cation will form. So in the cation form means, and then this cation will further degrade depending upon the structure of your molecule, and then from there it will come out. So multiple bombardments can happen to your molecules, and it will becoming as multiple fragments. So but the disadvantages of this GCMS spectra, first thing is that it is difficult to interpret if you are not an experienced analyst, because in a GCMS your compound don't have the electron is like Shivendra Sehwag. The electrons will go and bombard with each and every molecule entering into the chamber, and will convert that into different fragments. It is not going to bother about whether you are putting a carcinogenic compound, we are putting a solvent molecule. It is not least bothering in a GCMS instrument. So it is very difficult to identify what is the exact structure. And also one more disadvantages of the GCMS is that GCMS will be applicable only to volatile components. And Virendra Sehwag, this instrument, Virendra Sehwag is so volatile, this instrument is not applicable to non-volatile components. And there is practically any options for controlling the fragmentation. Then come our new tech. Then in 2002, these two gentlemen, John Biffen and Koichi Tanaka, they introduced a system called LCMS ionization. They got Nobel Prize in 2002 for their invention of atmospheric pressure ionization. These two gentlemen are mass spectroscopy is basically a physics concept. They use the physics concept and use the concept and then measured biological components, and then the mass came as chemistry. So it's a combination of all those things. In the LCMS, it is like Rahul Dravid. The uniqueness of Rahul Dravid, or the difference between Rahul Dravid and Virendra Sehwag, is Dravid is a very gentleman player. He will give full respect to the bowlers who is bowling to him, and rarely will see that he will make a sixer. In his entire history of his career, he made very few sixes, because he's a classic player. So we have an instrument called LCMS. In this LCMS chromatography, that is here, the chromatography part is liquid chromatography, where your mobile phase is liquid and your stationary phase is a silica column. This is how a typical LCMS looks like. What you are seeing on the right side is the mass detector, and the middle one is the HPLC part. So HPLC is high performance liquid chromatography. HPLC will separate your molecule based on the polarity and then the pK value, and then it will enter into the MS detector. So what you are seeing here is the comparison between EI spectrum and ESI spectrum. In EI spectrum, is like Virendra Sehwag's innings. So your molecule will get fragmented into many pieces. But in an ESI spectrum, it's a gentle technique, it's a gentle push, and you are going to get most of the time you will get M plus H, so molecular ion. So then it is very easy to interpret what exactly happening in an ESI, LCMS ESI instrument. So from the column, column will separate your analyte, and then it will come to a corona, and it will come to a capillary. So that you can see this orange color, this is the capillary tube. And in this capillary tube, we are keeping a temperature of 100 to 120 degrees Celsius. It is just little above the boiling point of water. So from the column, your analytes coming with the mobile phase of your HPLC. The mobile phase containing either water or acetonitrile or methanol. And so at the time you are keeping a temperature of around 100 to 120 Celsius, what is going to happen is your solvents will got evaporate off at this point. And if you keep a droplet of water on your table, it will remain as a liquid droplet. The reason is surface tension. So any liquid which is having surface tension will remain the form of a droplet. So now in this case, what is going to happen is one side you are increasing the temperature, and then size of your droplet is because of evaporation of your solvent, size of your droplet which is coming out from the HPLC column is slowly to reduce. At the same time, you are applying a very high voltage into this capillary tube. So the molecules, the analytes which coming from the HPLC column, either it will get protonate, say it's taking a charge is nothing but a proton, or if it is, it will deprotonate. Now you can see that your molecule is having, say it's having one NH2 group or amino basic group, it took one proton, and then it's all having charged species with positive charge, and then now you have a droplet. And droplet of with having the same charge of positive, and it will start to repel, either it is positive or negative, it will start repel. If the same charge, because of the capillary voltage, it will start to repel each against each other. At the same time, evaporation of the solvent is happening, and it, at a particular time, the force of repulsion exceeds the surface tension of your liquid, and these droplets will get explode. This is called Coulombic explosion, and each droplet containing thousands of the organic ions, and these ions, so we can see here is the formation of ions. That is reason this is reason it is calling us an atmospheric pressure ionization. So this is all happening in the atmospheric pressure, and you are putting a nebulizer gas. So once liquid formed and they are putting a nebulizer gas, it is come like a mist or mist form into the atmosphere pressure chamber. From that, your molecules with charged species is going to a hexapole or a quadrupole or octuple. If it is four coils, then it is called quadrupole. If it is six, it is called hexapole. If it is eight, it is called octopole. If, for example, for a quadrupole, you have four rods having opposite charge. Now your analyte got the charge, positive charge from the capillary voltage, capillary tube, and then it will attract by the negative charge in the quadrupole, and it will, the moment it will reach there, then it will get the negative charge from the quadrupole, and then since it got negative charge, then it will repel and it will go to the opposite tube, which is kept perpendicular to the quadrupole, and after reaching there, again it will go to the opposite charge, then again it will repel. So then it will move through this quadrupole based on the charge switching, and the mass ions will be separate through this quadrupole, and it will reach the detector. The good thing about, so this is the reason why we are telling that only the ionized compounds will be detected in LCMS, because it should be have a charge. If there is no charge, then it will not move through the quadrupole, it will go to the atmosphere, it will go to the waste. So that is the reason we are telling that only the compounds which can ionize will detect in LCMS. We have multiple techniques are available. One is called ESI, electrospray ionization. So here the reason why it is called electrospray ionization is that you are putting a nebulizer gas and it will spray the liquid which is coming from HPLC column as in the form of a spray, and then you are putting an electric charge, And then we have atmospheric pressure chemical ionization. In the atmospheric pressure chemical ionization, if your molecule are more or non-polar in nature, and it cannot take the charge directly from your capillary tube, what we are doing is we will put one corona needle, and this corona needle will make spark of the charge, electric charge, and that will create the electrons, and then it will pass that charge to the solvent vapor present inside the chamber, the vacuum chamber. That may be methanol or water. The water will take one proton, it will come H3O plus, and then it will transfer the charge to the analyte. So then it will get the charge instead of getting the charge from your capillary tube. And one more technique is there is called APPI, atmospheric pressure photoionization, where you will use the power of photon h nu as the for ionizing your molecule. Most of the latest instruments are coming with a concept called multimode. That means it connected with both ESI and then APCI. So 99% of your compounds are getting ionized in LCMS technique. Advantages of LCMS is there is most of the time you will get a base peak that will be M plus H. If it is took a proton, then it will be M plus H. If it's lost one proton, then it will be M minus H. So it will be very easy to interpret. Both volatile and non-volatile can be analyzed. GCMS, as I told, we can do only the volatile components, and there is very less sample preparation. You can directly dissolve in any solvent and you can inject into your instrument. Now came the another technique. It is more or less similar to the cool captain of Indian team, MS Dhoni. This technique is called tandem mass spectroscopy. It is liquid, if it is connected with the liquid chromatography, then it is called liquid chromatography tandem mass spectrophotometry, or it's called LC-MS-MS. If it is connected with a gas chromatography, then it is called GC-MS-MS. So what is the similarity between your LC-MS-MS and Mahendra Singh Dhoni? Mahendra Singh Dhoni is a cool captain who will change the speed of the game and depending upon the situations, and he was a good finisher. He know when a batsman or a player has to change the gear of scoring runs. This is exactly what LC-MS-MS instrument looks like. What you are seeing in the left is an HPLC part and right is an MS-MS part. So this is a typical LC-MS spectrum looks like. You are seeing that, say 164, that is the molecular ion, and when it is going to MS-MS, this 164 is fragmented into three ions, say 105, 91 and 57. So still this is a controlled fragmentation. It is not like an GC-MS. So there we don't know where what is the molecular peak which got converted into the fragments. So the LC-MS instrument, what we learned, is having three component, like in any other LC mass spectroscopy instrument, there are three components. One is ion source. In a GC, it is electron impact. In a LC-MS, it will be electro spray ionization or APCA or APPI. And then we have something called quadrupole that we have seen in the LC-MS, which separates the ions. So that is what is happening in LC-MS. In LC-MS-MS, we are going one more step ahead, where the source will generate the ions and it will separate by your quadrupole, and say it will separate hundreds of the analytes, but you are interested only in one of your ion. say a mass of 200, say in this case is 164. You want to cut that into pieces to understanding the structure, so that we are adding two more quadrupole. In fact, in reality, so you are putting only one more quadrupole. So first quadrupole separates the ions, then it is entering into a chamber like which is happening in GCMS, and this chamber is now filled with inert gas, not fast moving electrons, but inert gas. And we can adjust the electronic environment condition such a way that the mass to charge ratio, you can decide what kind of mass to charge ratio ions with mass to charge ratio should go to the chamber. In this case, I'm telling that whenever the mass to charge ratio is coming 164, only that ion should go to this chamber. So this 164 is going to the chamber, then it will get fragment. It's not the kind of a fragmentation which is, it will not be like a hard fragmentation which is happening in the electron impact, the GCMS. Here it will be a very soft fragmentation, and you will not see that much fragments, large number of fragments here. Then the whatever fragments happen, it will come out of the collision chamber, and then it will enter into the second quadrupole. Again, the quadrupole separates the fragmented ions. The ion which you selected is called the parent ion, and the ions which that fragmented is called the product ions. So this is a wonderful technique which is giving a very good information about the structure of the molecule. So this is a technique we are using, anion identification, and also this is a technique we are going to check sub ppm or picogram level quantitative analysis. So here you can see that, say 164 was the mass of your the main component, and you got 108 and 91 and 57. So based on that, now what I need to do is you have to we need to fix join these three molecule fragments together, so then I am getting the final molecule. So this is the way we are doing the structural elucidation. So the advantages here is only selected parent ion will be fragmented, and fragmentation can be controlled. It is helpful for structural elucidation, identification and quantification. Now we are going to change the cricket match, and you are all very much familiar with this cricketer. He is Sachin Tendulkar, the god of cricket. If you are thinking that in India cricket is considered to be a religion, and Sachin Tendulkar is a legend, and he was the god of cricket. The special thing about cricket, about Sachin Tendulkar, is that last long 20 years of career, whenever he is entering the field, he will rule the ground. He will make the square cut push. He will hit the boundaries. He will find out the gaps. He will play the match as he loves. So we have a technique called ion trap MSMS. Here you cut your molecule as you like. In the LC-MS-MS technique, tandem mass spectroscopy, what we have done is we selected an ion and then put it into a chamber, and then it is fragmented into many fragments, and then we analyzed the fragment, and we done such elucidation. In ion trap MSMS, here the opportunity here is having, say, a mass for me. My molecular ion is a mass 1363, and I can cut that 1363 into three fragments, and then I can select the three fragments. I can select only one fragment. I'm interested only in mass of 1249. Again, that 1249 I can cut into two pieces, many pieces. Then from that again I can select only one ion, so, and then again I will cut. So this is a very good technique when we are doing structural elucidation, especially when you are doing protein sequencing. I can cut each amino acid by step by step, and then I can do the structural elucidation. Now we are going ahead of one more step in the mass spectroscopy. So this cricketer is very much famous. It's notoriously famous in runouts. So this is the famous Pakistani cricket player Insam ul Haq. He has a dubious record of runouts. So, but now I'm going to talk about a mass spectroscopy instrument which is working on the principle of runouts. This is called time of flight QTOF-MS instrument, or it is also called high resolution mass spectrophotometry. This is a typical high resolution QTOF instrument. How it looks like? In the high resolution mass spectrophotometry, your ion source is nothing but the electrospin ionization or APCI ionization. From that, ions will generate, and it will go through the mass filter and collision cell. Then it reach a U-tube. It reach a tube, and when the molecule ions at reach the tube, it will get there is something called a pulsator, and this pulsator will give a small push. Till the pulsator, your molecules were moving only based on because of the vacuum and because of the charge difference of because of this quadrupole it was moving, and so the energy of your molecule was ions was potential energy. The when this reached near the tube, it got a pulsator give a pulse or a kind of a push, and all your ions got kinetic energy, and your ions all will start to fly through this tube. The same energy was given to all the analytes. Equation for kinetic energy is half m v square. V is velocity, or velocity is nothing but distance traveled divided by time. So kinetic energy is nothing but half m d divided by d by t the whole square. In this case, the energy given to all the components are same, all ions are same, and the distance traveling by all the ions are same because it starts to travel through the fixed tube. So then only thing which is difference is here is mass and the time of travel. The difference in the time of travel is a minute microseconds, but that minute microsecond is capable of differentiating between the ions. Say so in this case, if these are inversely proportional. So if your mass is more, the time will take more to reach the end point of tube. So based on the time of flight, we'll get the accurate mass. So why we are using this is exactly one the accurate mass instrument looks like, whereas you can see the previous slide we saw that the mass is 164.0. Here you are seeing 164.1433. This is called high resolution mass spectroscopy, and even high resolution mass spectroscopy, this mass this can be generated for the connected with an LC-MS-MS, and we can generate the molecular formula for both parent and the daughter ion. And from this accurate mass, we can generate the elementer formula for both parent and the daughter ion. I will explain how you calculate the elementer formula, how to use the time of flight in another video. So in this video we are going to talk. The time of flight is based on the time of flight of your analyte to the tube, and then that is directly proportional to the mass. You are getting accurate mass. Advantages of this technique is that we can measure the mass with high resolution and accuracy, and the elemental formula can be generated for parent, product and neutral loss ions. This is very much helpful when you are doing characterization of unknown components, because you can directly generate the elemental formula. That will be very helpful for structural elucidation. This is exactly how an LC-MS, UV-MS spectra looks like. So I injected a sample containing a mixture of three components, and first it will go through a UV detector, and it will see the three peaks. And this at a time I'm in my electro spray ionization, I'm keeping a polarity switching both positive and negative. So you will get two spectra. One is TSI positive, wherever the protonation happen. You will get an ESI minus, where deprotonation happen. So your molecule can have the property of attracting proton or removing the proton, losing the proton. So then it will show in both places. This is how friends, now I hope that you might have got a very good understanding about different techniques of mass spectroscopy through the language of cricket. Like, you have different formats of cricket match, we have different applications of mass spectroscopy. It sometimes you will use for structural elucidation, sometimes you will use for quantification, sometimes you will use this for protein sequencing. The application of mass spectroscopy is very much wide, but you should be a cool mass spectroscopist for winning the cups. Thank you very much for watching the video.